such a beautiful city with also such a rich history and also a lot of good science that is being done here in this city. So I hope to enjoy still a few more days here. But this evening, I really want to tell you a little bit about the story where we actually come from, where our Earth comes from, and where also the ingredients that make up us, where they actually come from. And it's going to be a little bit of a mystery tour. We're going to take a tour here through these very diffuse clouds that are in between the stars and see the ingredients that we get there, and maybe eventually make something that is alive and something that looks like our Earth. Alright, before we do that, I want to stress also the bigger picture. Because some of you may be physics students, chemistry students, science communicators, other fields, and you hear a lot of details about that physics, chemistry, etc. But once in a while, it's good to sort of step out and take the bigger picture. The biggest questions that we can have as mankind, namely, where do we come from? What is our place in this big universe? And of course, one of the biggest questions that we have, are we alone? And I'll come back to that part at the very end. But what I want to show here is that this question is not just fascinating to scientists, not just to astronomers, not just to scientists, but also artists. I mean, society is interested in these questions. And you see reflected in art. And one of my hobbies is actually astronomy and art. So here you see some of my favorite paintings. Of course, the Dutch painter, Vincent van Gogh, he just had to paint the starry night. Here you see the Big Dipper over the river Seine. Here you see the Aboriginals in Australia. They have the beautiful southern sky, the Milky Way that they see there. If you ever go to the southern hemisphere, look up because you'll see a beautiful sky there. The German expressionist, of course, Kandinsky here is one of my favorite painters. This is one of his paintings, Stars. He also has a painting called Comets. We'll talk about comets as well. And then here we have in the Pacific Northwest, first Raven actually taking a star out of a dark box and putting it on the sky. So that is their story of the origin of the sun. And actually taking something out of a dark box is something that we now know is actually quite related to how we think stars are actually forming out of a very dark cloud. So just to show that also I was walking around in your beautiful library and I saw this here. So this is was on the shelf over there. I will put it back. But it is also one of my other favorite painters, Miro. And here he also has stars. You see our stars and the moon. And he has a beautiful painting with comets, where you see the tail of the comets. So it's clearly something that fascinates people throughout society. All right, good. So let's start our story. And just to orient yourself, this is our own solar system. Of course, the sun we have over here, that is a star that shines due to nuclear fusion, nuclear reactions that happen in the interior of the sun. And then we have the planets. They actually reflect the light from the sun. And of course, the farther we go away, the colder it becomes. So here is our own little planet, Earth, just the right distance from the star, just where it's not too cold, not too warm. And this is also where water can be liquid, as we see over here, and you see in all the water that you have here around St. Petersburg. And then you'll see that is actually an important ingredient for the origin of life. Good, well, zooming out, we have our solar system. Now we go out into our galaxy, so our Milky Way. Our galaxy is basically a 200 billions of stars. So our sun is just one star out of those 200 billion stars. It's a rather ordinary star, and we live on a rather small planet, as you saw, circling around this star. Somewhere, you know, halfway in the outskirts of our galaxy. Nothing special about the location. And then, of course, our galaxy, our Milky Way, is only one of several hundred billion galaxies in the universe. Well, we now know that on average, every star has at least one planet. So this whole question, are we alone, are we unique, is already put in perspective just by these numbers. We'll come back to that. So, one of the most exciting progress actually in astronomy over the last decades has been the discovery of planets around other stars, so-called exoplanets. So other stars than our sun, exoplanets. First discovered only in 1995, and now some 4,000 of these exoplanets are known. And this, of course, leads to very fundamental questions that are age old, but are now being sort of revived. Namely, where and how are these stars and planets born? How unique is our solar system? We certainly know that planets are not unique anymore, but maybe our configuration, our solar system, could be unique still. And then, of course, which of these planets could be habitable? So we detect these planets, for example, when they pass in front of their mother star, then they dim the light just a tiny little bit. You see, it becomes a tiny little bit dimmer, maybe less than 1%. But that's enough that we can detect, and that then is an indication that there is a planet there. So think also of Venus. Venus went in front of the sun a few years ago, and that could also be seen actually as a tiny little dim. It became a little bit faint in the sun at that time. Here is sort of a cartoon of what we now know about all of these exoplanets. So it's really a zoo. A zoo in the sense that it's not one size fits all. A lot of different sizes. Some are bigger than Jupiter. It was a few times that of Jupiter. Or Saturn-like. Others are very small, some even smaller than the Earth. But the surprising thing is actually that the bulk of these exoplanets are of a type that we don't have in our own solar system. We have eight planets, going from Mars, the smallest, to Jupiter, the biggest, but it turns out that most of the exoplanets are of a type that are super Earths, a few times the mass of the Earth, or mini Neptunes. Neptune is about 10 times the mass of the Earth. So they are typically somewhere between 1 and 10 times the mass of the Earth, a type of planet we don't have in our own solar system. So that is already interesting. I mean, maybe we are unique. And that's in that respect already. Good. So, directly related to the question as to how do planets form and could there be life on them, there's also, of course, the billion euro, almost literally, given the cost of some of these missions. The billion-dollar question may be how was our solar system formed? How were we formed some 4.5 billion years ago? And you can see the sort of the outcome of that, well, we know what we have today, but sort of the building blocks from the formation of our solar system, we can still observe and we can still probe. And especially in the inner part of the solar system, we can look at meteorites. So meteorites are basically small pieces of asteroids. Bigger blocks of typically, say, a kilometer in diameter, smaller pieces that fall on Earth on a daily basis, almost a ton or so per day, And you can then pick them up and you can study them in a laboratory. And that tells us something about the formation of the inner solar system. And in fact, there are two missions at this moment, Hayabusa 2 and Osiris Rex. Those are the names of these missions, one Japanese, one from NASA, that actually are now landing actually on such an asteroid. So here you see a picture of an asteroid. This is about several hundred meters in diameter. And this is where they are trying to pick a sample and land there and also bring that sample back to Earth. In the outer solar system, it's much colder. So we have not just rock, but we also have ice in the outer solar system. And that is actually what comets are. Comets are basically dirty snowballs, or icy dirt balls, about snow and dirt in a ratio of 1:1. And so when they come close to the sun, then the ice starts to sublimate. It starts to come back from ice into the gas. And then you get these beautiful tails that you see in the comet. Now, a few years ago, a mission from the European Space Agency, the Rosetta mission, actually landed on a comet for the first time. And it basically sniffed the gases that are coming out of the comet there. And I'll come back to that mission at the end of my talk. Because both of these types of missions are actually messengers from our own early solar system. This one from the inner part of the solar system, and this one from the cold outer part of the solar system. So they are part of this whole story of how we were formed, because they tell us something about it. Okay, good. So let's start at the beginning. Where do we actually form stars? Where do we start actually our chemistry? So if you look up at the night sky on a beautiful clear night, maybe tonight, it's away from the city, not too many, not too much lights for pollution, and you see stars, the base of a few planets. But few of you may have wondered what is actually in between the stars. Well, the regions between the stars are actually not empty, but they are actually filled with very, very dilute gas. On average, just 1 atom per cubic centimeter. And it's actually inside these dense, these clouds that stars are born. So let's take a tour here. Do you recognize this constellation?
Orion.
Yes, exactly. So here we have, so it's basically the Hunter. So here we have his upper part of his body. And here you have a sword, here you have this belt, and here is actually the Orion Nebula. And that was found already by Galilei and also by Christian Huygens. They saw this nebula already with a small telescope, and now we know that this nebula is actually the nursery of many more stars, thousands of new stars. So this is a modern image taken with the very large telescope that you see over here. It's slightly longer wavelengths, so going to more to longer wavelengths actually, and then we see all of these stars. And William Herschel already speculated that this nebula could well be the chaotic material of future stars. Here we zoom out. So this was the part of the Orion Nebula that I just showed. Now we zoom out and now we see this nebula in its full glory. This is an image taken with the Hubble Space Telescope. The red part that you see over here is actually very hot gas. It's ionized gas, 10,000 degrees. That's not only for ion molecules, that's not only for a star. It's just for making very nice pictures and very colorful pictures. And the part that we are actually interested in is this very dark regions that you see here. And as you will see, that is the region where new stars are being born and where we also form the molecules. Now, in fact, it was Victor Aubuchon, who I think comes from St. Petersburg. He worked at St. Petersburg. observatory here, who was one of the very first to realize that stars do not have eternal life. Up to about 1950, the astronomers, physicists, still thought that stars were part of cosmology. Basically, you know, there was once, basically, they were part of the creation of the universe. But then he realized, by looking at certain types of stars, that that is not true, that basically stars are born and stars also die again. And some stars die quicker than others, so the more massive the star, the quicker they live and the shorter their lifetimes, whereas the small stars actually have a very long lifetime. And that was a very important contribution from St. Petersburg, actually, right over here. Okay, so let's actually now look at these dark clouds. So here we are actually at the Carina Nebula. So again, it's visible wavelengths, the light that we can see with our own eyes. And now we are traveling actually through these clouds. So if I would actually point my telescope here at one of these dark regions, then I would see there new stars forming and also molecules being there. Now these clouds are some of the biggest objects that we can have in our galaxy. Their sizes are up to several light years. Masses, enough mass to form maybe 10,000 new stars, or 100,000 new stars. It will not do it. It will do it with an efficiency of only a few percent. But the raw material for forming new stars is there. Now, why are these clouds dark? Well, they are actually dark because they contain tiny little dust grains. You know, think of sand particles on the beach, silicate material, but then 10,000 times smaller than a sand grain on the beach, only a fraction of a micrometer inside. And these dust grains are important because they absorb and they scatter the light. So think of when you have smoke, and you're in used to be smoky cafes, you know that you could not look very deep into them. Or when you have smoke in the atmosphere, you also know that you can't. Study what is inside the cloud. For that, we have to put on different glasses. We have to basically go to longer wavelengths, so not the wavelengths that we can see with our eyes, but we go to longer and longer wavelengths. And if you go just a little bit to the infrared, we now already have less absorption and scattering from these dust grains, and we can actually look through the clouds and see the background and stars. So here's a little movie from real data from an infrared telescope, where we actually move from visible light to infrared light, and now we see that at infrared, now I see that there's actually a young star actually sitting inside this cloud. So here's again visible, it's just a dark cloud, and now we go to longer and longer wavelengths, we're zooming in, and now I see that actually inside that cloud, there is a young star that is at this very moment trying to push away its surrounding cloud. It basically has a jet, an outflow, trying to push that away. But the main message is that we actually need long wavelengths in order to penetrate these dusty regions. And so we are fortunate to actually have very powerful telescopes in order to do so. So here are some of the telescopes that I've worked with. The Infrared Space Observatory, which flew from 1995 to 1998. The first space telescope actually that could observe above the Earth's atmosphere and search for molecules there. And of course, we need to go above the Earth's atmosphere because our atmosphere is full of water, it's full of CO2, it's full of oxygen, and so we need to go above the Earth's atmosphere in order to see the signals from space. Then came the Spitzer Space Telescope from the NASA in the US, also very powerful, and all of this culminated with the Herschel Space Observatory, which flew in 2009 for 4 years, and then it ran out of its coolant, so you need to cool these instruments on these telescopes, and that was really very well suited for observing water. And I'm signaling out here one instrument that's called the high-frequency instrument, the Hi-Fi instrument, which was actually designed to observe water in all its details in star-forming regions. And so it was actually built in the Netherlands in a consortium with many different countries. So just to give you a little impression as to how technology has progressed over the last 30, 40 years. This is an image, a single pixel image of a star from a cloud as was made in the 1970s and 1980s. And these are some of the beautiful images that Herschel has given us of similar regions. And so you see just the beauty here. You see here the radiation from the cold dust grains, and all of these little dots that you see here, these are all protostars, these are all young stars that are actually forming here inside this star-forming cloud. Good, so satellites are fantastic, but they are also very expensive, and you can never have a very big telescope in space. 3.5 meters Herschel, that was the biggest space telescope ever. Even the Hubble is smaller, only 2.2 meters. So the big telescopes you have on the ground, and we are fortunate to have access to some of the biggest telescopes here in the, on the ground. In fact, for a long time, Russia had a record here with the 6 meter diameter optical telescope in the Caucasus, there, the Bolshoi telescope. Now we have 8 to 10 meter class telescopes here from the European Southern Observatory in northern Chile, or the CAT telescopes on Hawaii. And there are now plans to build even bigger telescopes, extremely large telescopes, not very imaginative name, a very large telescope and an extremely large telescope. But it gives the impression discussion as to where we're going, bigger and bigger. And this will have, this is an artist's impression, this will have a diameter of some 39 meters. So compared to 8 to 10 meters, that's enormous journey again. And that's what we're going to need in order to search for signs of life on other planets. A third type of telescopes is going even longer wavelengths to the radio part of the spectrum and the millimeter part of the spectrum. And here, this is a fantastic new telescope, the Atacama Large Millimeter Array, called ALMA. It's the first worldwide collaboration in astronomy. It's a collaboration to Europe, to East Asia, and also North America. And together they have put 66 antennas, radio antennas, on a high altitude plane here in northern Chile. And here you see the array at the time of the inauguration, which was a few years ago in 2013. And ALMA is really very well suited to observe a myriad of different objects. So here you see actually how ALMA was built. It's quite a technological feat, also a little bit of a logistical nightmare, because you need to bring components from all over the world to northern Chile. So you need to bring telescopes from East Asia, from Japan, from North America, from Europe, and they all need to come together here on this high altitude plane, put together, tested here in all details. When they are tested, they are put on a big truck, gigantic truck, and then driven up from 3,000 meters up to 5,000 meters, and then put here into the array. So it's really also a very great technological challenge. And so here is basically where we see ALMA, and here is zooming out. This is one of the most beautiful areas that I know on Earth. It's a fantastic area here with all these volcanoes that you see over here, and I can tell you that it is both literally and figuratively a breathtaking experience to be there, because we're at 5,000 meters altitude there, so you can hardly lose there. Good, so ALMA is telling us a lot about the chemistry. Good, so this was sort of how we observe molecules, where we find molecules in these clouds, we need telescopes for that. Let's now do a little bit of chemistry. So this is the astronomer's view, actually, of the periodic table. So it looks a little bit different from what you have on high school or what you may get in your chemistry lectures. It's basically telling you that hydrogen is by far the most abundant element. If you put that at one by number, then helium is about 10%. But helium, of course, doesn't do much chemically. The chemically more interesting elements, carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen, they are present at a level of a few times 10 minus 4, so a fraction of a promille. And if you go to the next row in the periodic table, it's even less. So we have this very tenuous gas, mostly hydrogen. Atoms meet each other maybe only once every other month or so, or maybe every other year. And so a chemist would always tell astronomers, don't even bother to search for molecules because you won't find them. Well, it turns out to be different. We actually find a whole wealth of molecules. So just to show you as to where these elements are basically produced, so this is what is happening in the other side of town at the Mendeleev day of conference. This is basically showing you that these elements like iron, silicon, carbon, oxygen, etc., they're made by nuclear fusion in stars, and then when the star dies, in this case when it explodes actually as a supernova, like here in the Cassiopeia, a supernova remnant, then they return these elements actually to the interstellar medium, where they can actually then form the basis for the next generation of stars. So the elements in your body, this is why we say literally that we are all stardust, because we basically come from on this material. Good. So people actually did find quite a lot of molecules in space in spite of these very tenuous and cold conditions. If I point ALMA for just 30 seconds at the Orion Nebula, I will get something that looks like this. And what you're looking at here is the spectrum. It's basically the, like when you tune your radio, you tune your frequencies, and then every time you get a woo, that I hit the signature of yet another molecule. And so I will go through that, but I'll just show you that we have methanol here, CH3OH, methanol, we have ether here, we have sulfur dioxide here, and just this whole range of molecules. And we can identify them uniquely because every molecule, thanks to the laws of quantum mechanics, has its own pattern, has its own fingerprint. Or you can also think of it as a barcode, basically, that like you have in the supermarket, and everyone has a barcode, you can uniquely identify every product. So what do we find? Many different types of molecules. We find ordinary molecules, water, ammonia, formaldehyde. This is a molecule that you probably know. Alcohol, yes, good. Well, there's quite a bit of alcohol in space. The Orion Nebula probably has enough to make some 10 to the 27 bottles of vodka. So, if you are dry at the end of the night, consider taking a spacesuit and tapping a beer out of the cloud. But it's not 40% with respect to water, it's of the order of 1%. Anyways, there's quite a bit of alcohol there. There are also much more exotic molecules actually in these clouds. Won't even go through their names, but you see these very long carbon chains here. It's just one hydrogen on it. Now, this is weird because hydrogen is 10,000 times more abundant than carbon. And yet we find molecules which have lots of carbon and just one hydrogen. So these are very unusual molecules, unusual on Earth, not on space. They are very stable molecules actually in space. And they tell us that the chemistry in space is not in thermodynamic equilibrium, but that it's actually determined by the kinetics between the various species. So here are some complex organic molecules that actually have been found in space. Simple sugars, like you see over here, alcohol that you already discussed, the ether that you have over here, all molecules that are already getting on in a little bit of complexity. Not yet detected are some of the molecules that one may consider to be building blocks of life, like the simplest amino acid, glycine, not yet detected. Claimed, but not yet detected. And similar with the bases that you need for RNA or DNA, purine, also not yet detected. This little molecule, which may not be important for the origin of life, but is definitely important for the maintenance of life, caffeine, has also not yet detected. The point of this slide is that these molecules are not that much more complex compared with those that have already been seen, and so with ALMA we can go significantly deeper. In fact, tricarbon molecules are now being discovered, like you see over here, the cyanides, the side chains that are precursors of amino acids, and the first chiral molecule, in this case, propylene oxide, has just been detected a couple of years ago. We don't know yet whether it's left-handed or right-handed. We need different types of measurements for that, but at least the chiral molecule is present. We also know of even more complex molecules, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. You all know of these molecules because they are present in the exhaust of your car, or if you leave your meat a little bit too long on the barbecue, then you also make lots of PAHs. We know that these molecules are present as a class of molecule, but we cannot identify them individually, so we don't know whether it's choline or naphthalene or any of the other aromatics. except this one, benzonium nitrile, which has just been discovered a year ago, has been identified. Another type of molecule that we definitely know is present in space are the fullerenes, C60 and C70 that you see here, and that have been detected in dying stars. And in fact, when they were first discovered on Earth, Henri Croteau, he actually was an astrochemist. He was thinking about these long carbon chains, and he was wondering, what happens when they grow bigger and bigger? Will they stay as a chain, or will they start to fold into each other? That's how he got sort of his inspiration for the fullerenes and the fullerene research. So you can say that interstellar chemistry has also helped to lead to these Nobel Prize discoveries. Now, so far we've talked about molecules in the gas, but these grains are very cold. They basically act as a deep freeze, and that means that elements and molecules, when they collide with the grain, they will actually stick on it and freeze out. And so think of your car window on a cold winter night, then the molecules from the atmosphere will actually freeze out onto your front window and form an icy layer. And that is what we also have in space. And that's nice because then actually while on the grain we have different reactions. That's actually, as we'll see in a moment, where we make water. That's where we make methane. That's where we make ammonia. And if you have carbon monoxide and you hydrogenate it, you add hydrogens to it, then you actually get methanol. So the alcohol in space is actually literally on the rocks as you have it there. And we also have a little bit of the bubbles, CO2, that's also present on the grain. So we have literally an ice cocktail in space. Now, we actually are simulating these kinds of processes in the laboratory that we have in Leiden. And so here you see our setup with several of the PhD students actually working on it. The lab is now led by Harold Dillard. Of course, we cannot simulate all the conditions. We don't want to wait 10,000 years for a reaction to happen. Our students need to be able to do the experiment in a day, but we can get it as cold and we can get it as tenuous as possible. All right, so these kind of experiments have actually led to insight as to how water is formed in space. So here we have our dust grains in the interstellar cloud, and now we have about once a day a hydrogen atom landing on it. Let me see, there it comes, yeah, there it comes, it finds another hydrogen, over there it goes off and it makes molecular hydrogen. But we also have oxygen on the grains, oxygen that slowly moves over the grains, out there, they to find each other, they have molecular oxygen, and now we make actually hydrogen peroxide. And now with another collision, we actually form two water molecules. And now from a day, we fast forward to 10,000 years. And now we see that we are actually making lots of water molecules. And we are actually making an icy layer here on the surfaces of these tiny little dust grains. So this is an animation, obviously, but it's based on real experiments carried out in three different locations on Earth. And all of them also see the intermediates like hydrogen peroxide, etc., that are happening there. So, actually, one of my colleagues said, because this is how the bulk of the water that we have here in the universe is actually formed. It's actually formed on these tiny little dust grains. And as one of my colleagues said, basically, this tells us basically that water is older, all the water that we have on Earth is actually older than the Sun itself, because it was formed already in this cloud, in this dense cloud, before it collapsed to form a star. So think about that. The water that I have here in this glass, the water that I have here in my body, that is in your beautiful sea over here, those water molecules are more than 4.5 billion years old. And of course they have sublimated and recondensed again, evaporated, etc. But the bonds between the hydrogen and oxygen was formed already 4.5 million years ago. So think about it the next time you take a sip of your water. Good. And we actually actually detect this water. This Herschel hi-fi instrument detected in, say, planet-forming regions, and you can then translate the strengths of this signal into how much water there is, and then we find actually that there is, in this particular region, about 6,000 oceans of ice present. Now, our Earth has a few oceans, so it tells us that yes, there is enough water present there in the sky. Now, actually, this has not gone unnoticed, even by the Big Bang theory here, and you see that they were actually looking here at water and ionized water, as observed by the Herschel satellites when they were talking here about science. Good, so the summary so far. Interstellar clouds actually have a very rich composition in spite of the cold and tenuous conditions. And complex organic molecules in water are actually found around nearly all the forming stars wherever we look throughout the entire Milky Way. So, first conclusion, the building blocks for prebiotic material are widespread. All right, let's now turn to some physics. So we have our cloud, and I want to make a star out of it. How does that happen? Well, basically, it just collapses under its own weight. So basically, for a long time, say 10 million years, it can sustain itself, but then eventually gravity wins, and it will collapse to form a protostar at the center. Now, because the cloud always has a tiny little bit of rotation, that means that the material cannot continue to fall in regularly, but part of it will come into a rotating disk here around a young star. And that disk has a size that is comparable with that of our own solar system. So an astronomical unit is the distance from the Sun to the Earth, and so 50 astronomical units is about the distance from the Sun to the edge of our solar system, so beyond Pluto. So this is about the size of our solar system. So let's look at let's go back to Orion again, and let's travel through Orion, and there we have the Trapezium stars again, and let's just see if you can find these protostars. So yeah, all of these are protostars. They're basically cocoons in which a new star is forming. And now we go actually to a simulation. Here we see a simulation. There's a young star sitting here inside this cloud still, this collapsed cloud. And now it's blown away by this bipolar jet here. And what we see here left is the rotating disk of gas and dust around it, and that's where the planets come from. Now, that's all nice, but these disks, as you see here in the artist's impression, are very small. So, on this scale of this same picture, here we have the clouds, we can easily see it, but our disk is tiny here on this scale, about 1,000 times smaller. So this is why we actually needed to build ALMA. We needed the sharpness of ALMA in order to zoom in on these clouds and to the disk. And that's exactly what ALMA is doing at this moment. ALMA is so powerful, we can just point ALMA at any of the young stars in the Lupus star-forming region, that's just the constellation Lupus, which has a lot of young stars, and we point ALMA at each of these young stars for just 1 minute, and we find these dust disks around it. Very good data. And we can do that for lots of other clouds. And what do we find? Well, we find that virtually all of these young stars are surrounded by these disks. The sizes of these disks are comparable to that of our own solar system. The masses of these disks, and do we have enough material to form a new solar system? The answer is, well, sometimes, yes, we do have enough material to form something like our own solar system. We need about 10 times the mass of Jupiter for that, to make our own solar system. Other disks have enough material to form our solar planets. So also the ingredients for planet formation are also common. So we have now two important ingredients for making new solar systems. How about the chemistry on this scale? So previously we looked at chemistry on the scales of a whole cloud. Let's now zoom in. Oh, wow. glycol aldehyde that you see over here. So here are just some of the complex molecules that we recently detected now on solar system scale. So again, and you see here the beginnings of a peptide bond, CNO, and that we could call a prebiotic molecule. Good, so also these ingredients are present on solar system scales, so that's also good to know. Go back a little bit to art. This is one of my favorite engravings. It's already from 1798, well before people knew about the planets around other stars. But this artist already speculated about planets around other stars. And here's our own solar system, 7 planets at the time. But these other solar systems, they don't look anything like our own solar system. Some have more planets, some less, some closer by, and some further away. So this shows already the diversity of planetary systems, and that's exactly what we are seeing now in the observations such as the Kepler satellite, where we see this huge diversity of very big planets, very small planets, etc. So what is the origin of this planetary diversity? Well, that must lie in the past at the time of their formation in this protoplanetary disk, as you see over here. With Alma, we cannot see the young planet itself, but what we can see is the gaps that they actually made here in this disk. And that is actually what we are observing in this disk. So, so that's it. How we now make it planets. We have these tiny little dust grains. Here we have our rotating dusty disk. And what is happening here? Well, these dust grains will collide with each other. They will form bigger and bigger objects. Ah, look at that here. You see? They're forming bigger and bigger and bigger objects. It goes step by step. We go from micrometer size to millimeter size to 7 meter size, now we're the size of pebbles. We get to stones, to bricks, etc. So this is actually how we make sort of larger and larger objects. And this is then what we now see in our ALMA observations. This is some brand new data that come from the ALMA telescope. And we start to see actually these gaps, these cavities that a young planet can actually, you know, a little bit like a snow collector, can actually make here in inside these disks. And these are the signs that probably planets are actually forming at this very moment in these disks. So we've now entered, just in the last few years, the era that we have actually seeing planet formation in action. So, very briefly, what I just described, we started off with our micro-sized grains, which are very chemically rich in terms of ices. Then we grow to larger bodies, say kilometer size, those we actually call planetesimals, that is the size actually of comets. Then we form planetary embryos, sort of lunar size, moon size, Mars size, and then through gravity these interact and may or may not form something that looks like our Earth. But these planetesimals, these are actually interesting because this is when gravity starts to take over. These are the real building blocks of planets. And this is also exactly the size of comets. A comet is basically a dirty ice ball of a few kilometers in diameter. And sometimes you see these beautiful comets on the night sky. This was in 1996. You could see it with your naked eye everywhere, even in cities. You're looking for sort of the next beautiful comet, no, for a comet in the not too distant future. Here is then a cold comet in the outer part, that's a Rosetta mission to went to. And one of the questions that we now have is, have these comets actually preserved this interstellar material? Is there a close connection? So this is what the Rosetta mission did. It went to this comet and tried to determine its composition. It's actually named after two Russian observers, Churyumov and Gerasimenko. You can say it much better than I can. And they Comet 67P. And in 2004, the Rosetta mission was launched. This is the orbit of the comet. And after some flybys here in the solar system to get enough speed and to get the orbit right, it was actually here. It actually started to catch up with the comet. And in January 2014, it met with the comet. And then in 2014, it arrived at 40 kilometers, and then it actually circled around the comet. It traveled with the comet for almost 2 years, at somewhere between 10 and 100 kilometers distance. Made beautiful pictures. Here is actually a selfie of Rosetta with the comet that you have here. Here you see sort of the neck of the comet, which was the most active. So here it's actually losing gas, about 2 liters of water per second. Maximum was about 5 liters of water per second that it was losing. This is a blow up, sort of a zoom in on the landing site where the Rosetta mission actually landed. I should say actually on the little lander that Rosetta had. So Rosetta consists of most of the mothership and the little lander called Philae that was actually landing here on this region. It's varied terrain, it's beautiful actually, it has cliffs, it has dunes, you can see stones actually moving over there. You see here all kinds of cracks appearing. So it's may not be, you know, one comet in the end, maybe after a few passages it will break in two. So now it looks sort of like a duck, but it may actually break in two in a number of years. Anyways, this is sort of the proof that Philae landed on the comet. In fact, it bounced a little bit because the harpoon didn't work properly. But in the end, it landed somewhere over here and took data. So, what have we learned actually from this comet? So, one of the most sensitive instruments was actually on the mothership, not on the lander. And that was the Rosina instrument. You can see that it's a mass spectrometer, a very sensitive mass spectrometer. And it basically means that Rosetta had a very good nose. It could actually sniff the gases that were coming out of this comet. And what did it sniff? Actually, water, carbon dioxide, methane, all these same molecules that we had also seen in our interstellar gases. It was a little bit of a surprise that what did it also see? Molecular oxygen. That was one molecule that we have not found yet in our data. It's difficult to observe. It's a symmetric molecule. It's not easy to observe. But it found it actually in quite large amounts in this comet. And that is because it could distinguish it very nicely from sulfur and methanol by mass, because it had such a high mass by solution. And this high abundance of O2 in comets actually told us something about the formation of our own solar system. It probably happened in a cloud with lots of other stars and a little cluster of stars, which made our cloud a little warmer than a normal cloud. Now, what Rosina actually sniffed up from the comet was lots of different molecules. Simple molecules that we've seen before, like oxygen and water, etc. But also some complex molecules, like this one here. The lion king of all of the molecules, glycine, the simplest amino acid. It actually found it here in this comet. The alcohols are over here, that you see over here. Sulfur bearing molecules. So it's really a zoo, literally a zoo of different molecules that we found here. And actually the composition of that that we find in that comet looks very much like also the composition that we have in our interstellar clouds and interstellar space. So this suggests that yes, the material that we started out with that was in this collapsing cloud that came to this disk is largely preserved in the material that ultimately makes planets. Can it actually arrive on planets? The answer is yes, these comets can see that because the water that we have in our ocean, you know, the earth that you have here outside St. Petersburg, is not just normal water, but it is a little bit of heavy water. So it has also deuterium atom in it. And that ratio of these two is very characteristic. It's not like what we have in the sun. It's really characteristic of the chemistry that we have in space. And so this is one of the proofs that we have that, yes, these comets were actually important in delivering water and organics on Earth. Now, once we have water on a young planet, on a new planet, are they habitable? Well, that depends still on how cold or how warm it is. You need to be in this habitable zone, not close to the mother star, not far away where water is living. And where that habitable zone is depends on the properties of the star. In the sun, the Earth is just at the right distance. If you have a smaller star, the habitable zone is somewhat closer by. And once you then have, you know, this water and you lay it live, how do we recognize it? Well, look here at Venus, Earth, Mars. All three of them have CO2, quite a lot. But only Earth has other elements in here, water, ozone, CH4, and that is how we can detect it. So will there be life on one of these planets? So this is a very nice system that was discovered a couple of years ago. It's a small star, but it has seven Earth-like planets. And three of them, B, C, and D, actually lie in the habitable zone. This was discovered by a Belgian astronomer, and so that's how we got to choose the name, TRAPPIST. So in case you're wondering why it got its name there. This is another target for future observations. Our nearest star, our neighbor star, Proxima Centauri, in the Centaurus constellation, that is now also known to have a planet around it that you see here in an artist's impression, Proxima B. It may look something like this, it may not look something like this. But the point is that with the new generation of telescopes, these extremely large telescopes, they actually have the sensitivity to search for these biomarkers, to search for water, to search for ozone, to search for CH4, nitrogen oxide, etc., in the atmospheres of these planets. And so that is why we are always driven by new technology, always go to the next generation of big telescopes that you see over here. And it's not too far away, it's only, you know, less than a decade away that we can start to point these telescopes there. So, I want to end here by putting again things in a little bit of perspective. So, this is a very famous image, the pale blue dot image. It was taken by the Voyager mission that made a tour of our own solar system, launched already 50 years ago. And when it was past Saturn, Voyager 1 looked back again, turned around, looked back again, and took a picture of Earth. And this is us. We are this tiny, tiny little dot there in the middle of the Earth. So this is one thing that we actually provide as astronomy. We try to do a lot of physics, chemistry, etc. But we also provide a little bit of perspective. Some modesty, we are only that tiny little dot out there. And given the fact that we all are living on the same planet, it also gives us a sense of tolerance. Now this is actually what we, from the International Astronomical Union, are also promoting. We actually have our centenary celebration this year. I'm currently the president of the International Astronomical Union, which is the union of all professional astronomers worldwide. And we're celebrating our centenary, these 100 years, as our motto, Under One Sky. Basically signaling that we're all world citizens under the same beautiful sky. We're having lots of activities, more than 4,000 activities in more than 100 countries. Also, of course, obviously here in Russia. And I invite you to look also at this website and to see how you can participate. So, I want to end here and just say, world citizens and enjoy this beautiful sky that we have. Thank you very much.